Welcome everyone to tonight's York seminar. I'm really pleased tonight to have Dr. Nick Brooks, who is a research fellow at the Climatic Research Unit at the University of East Anglia, and is also co-director of the Western Sahara Project. Nick is also a consultant in international development and climate change training and evaluation and that sort of thing. So he really combines a lot of interests, and as well as his archaeology in the Sahara, it combines issues of conflict and politics, which really sort of add to the layers of interest. So we're looking forward to hearing Nick tonight on a variety of subjects, I think.
Okay, well, thanks, Ed. It's a pleasure to be here in York. I've been through York many times on the train on the way to Edinburgh, but I've never got off, so this is a great opportunity to stop in the city. As Ed said, I combine a number of different roles these days. As my older sort of academic work in climate change and archaeology has persisted as I've made the transition in terms of livelihood to consultancy. So there will be quite a bit sort of in this talk. And another thing I'd say up front is that if people want to interrupt me, if anything's unclear, if you have any questions that you think you might forget by the end, do feel free to raise your hand and interrupt me. I'm quite happy to stop and take questions throughout the talk. So this seminar is titled Refuges in the Desert, Cultural Heritage and Conflict in the Western Sahara. So I'm going to talk about the work I've been doing with colleagues in Western Sahara, which is essentially archaeology combined with studies of past environmental change, but also that sort of bled into more sort of cultural heritage relevant areas, because we're working in a context where, you know, we have to deal with the realities of working in somewhere that's essentially a conflict zone, although mercifully there's no fighting at present. So first of all, I'm going to talk about the geographic, political and cultural contexts of our work in Western Sahara. Then I'll say something about the scientific contexts, which is really about sort of the wider archaeological and environmental context of the Sahara at large. Then I want to run through and summarize the results of our field surveys in terms of what they tell us about past changes in the environment, and also what we've gleaned from the archaeological record and the points of interest from looking at the archaeology of the region. And finally, I'm going to talk somewhat about how the archaeology and the related area of cultural heritage really interacts with the context of political conflict in Western Sahara. So, I don't know, can I have a quick show of hands? Who here does know where Western Sahara is and is familiar with it and does feel they know something about the geographical political context before coming to this talk? Raise your hand if you feel relatively well informed about it. Okay, that's a good start. So you're not alone. This is very representative. So normally when you say Western Sahara, people think you mean, oh, the western regions of the Sahara. But Western Sahara is actually a specifically defined territory, highlighted in red here. It's not quite a country, as we'll discuss over the next few slides, but it is a distinct territory sandwiched between the Atlantic, Morocco, Mauritania, and Algeria. We can see on the right-hand map here, historically it's been divided into two areas. One's known as the Rio de Oro, the southern area, and the other is called the Senhor Hamra. Named after the not particularly wet river system that drains into the Atlantic there. So the political status of Western Sahara is that of a disputed non-self-governing territory. Non-self-governing territory is a formal designation by the United Nations for territories or putative countries, we can say, that have not yet had their final status determined in the aftermath of colonialism. Western Sahara was the Spanish Sahara until 1975. It was a colony of Spain. And in 1975, with the death of Franco, Spain decided to withdraw and not have a colony in Western Sahara anymore. So in the few years prior to 1975, there'd been a political movement established called the Polisario, which is the Spanish acronym for the, well, it's the version of the acronym for the Frente Popular para la Liberación de Seguro Hamra y Rio de Oro, so Popular Front for the Liberation of Seguro Hamra and Rio de Oro. This was established to basically fight against the Spanish for independence. Initially, they got some support from Morocco in their struggle for independence, and I think partially on the basis that Morocco assumed that they might then want to be part of Morocco. So in 1975, when the Spanish withdrew, Morocco and Mauritania invaded Western Sahara. The idea was that they were going to sort of carve it up. Morocco would have the northerly parts and Mauritania would have the southern parts. So of course, the Polisario, representatives of the indigenous Sahrawi people there, fought against Morocco and Mauritania. They wanted to be independent. They didn't want their post-colonial status to be that of another province of Morocco. So there was an armed conflict. The Polisario declared the establishment of the Sahrawi Arab Democratic Republic. They defeated Mauritania in 1978, and by 1991, they'd come to some sort of accommodation with Morocco through the means of a UN-mediated ceasefire. By 1991, Morocco had built a number of earthworks, which by that stage came to constitute a wall, a berm, that stretched all the way through the territory. Do we have a pointy stick anywhere? Or so this hatched area encompasses the berm. The berm is the red line that goes all the way from the northeast to the southwest of Western Sahara. It's essentially a series of earthworks and fortifications with forts and minefields that divides Western Sahara in two, that partitions the territory. So to the west, we have the areas controlled by Morocco, and to the east, we have the areas controlled by the Polisario. I think I'm right in saying the berm is the largest military structure in the world or something. So, sure, yeah, do you have a...
Sorry, what's the scale on this thing? I can just not see it from
there. Okay. Is there a scale somewhere? So
how wide is that restricted area?
Sorry?
How wide is that?
The restricted area, okay. So the hatched area is 30 kilometers either side of the berm. So this is 60 kilometers here. I think Western Sahara in its entirety is something similar to the size of the UK, really. So yeah, 30 kilometers area where the UN ceasefire stipulates that there's going to be very, very limited sort of activity in terms of military presence and so on. So this is the current situation. Western Sahara is effectively partitioned into Moroccan and a Polisario-controlled zone. When the UN established the ceasefire, it also installed an observer force, a peacekeeping force, whose mandate was to monitor the ceasefire, but more importantly, to organize a referendum on self-determination and thus complete the decolonization process so that the status of this non-self-governing territory could finally be established. That referendum has never happened. Morocco has consistently maintained that it won't entertain the idea of an independent Western Sahara. Polisario consistently say that they want an independent Sahara and that must be on the table, so there's a stalemate there. But the UN continues to have a presence there. Every year the mandate is renewed, and there's been less and less emphasis on actually organizing the referendum. As a result of the conflict, most of the indigenous Sahrawi population are now in refugee camps around the Algerian town of Tindouf, just to the northeast of Western Sahara. So we have 165 to possibly 2,000 people living there, probably 100,000 Sahrawi living in the Moroccan-occupied areas, and Morocco has installed a lot of its own settlers there and put a lot of money and investment into the territory to develop the infrastructure there. So it's a bit of a stalemate. In terms of the cultural context, the indigenous people there, the Sahrawi, are a mixture of Arab and Berber populations. Excuse me. They have their own distinct language called Hassaniya, which is quite distinct from the Arabic spoken in the neighboring countries, although obviously related to it. Previously, they were nomadic herders, but obviously with the conflict and modernization, there's very little of that going on these days. There are still a few families or individuals that practice old nomadic lifestyles within Western Sahara and in the Polisario-controlled areas, certainly. And people try and sort of capture some essence of that old lifestyle by leaving the camps when climatic conditions and rainfall is good, that enable them to actually go and spend a few months in what they call the free zone, the Polisario-controlled areas. Some of the families keep herds of camels and goats there, and they go and sort of enjoy living off the bounty of their livestock when conditions permit. Since the 1970s, there's been an upsurge in Sahrawi nationalism, essentially the creation of a national identity as a result of the conflict with Morocco. And through this sort of resurgent nationalism, there's been strong efforts by the Polisario in particular to sort of maintain a cultural identity. So they have things like cultural festivals every year in the camps, and that's resulted in the creation of this sort of national identity amongst the Sahrawi people. So in terms of our work in Western Sahara, we initially received an invitation through a long sort of set of events that I won't bore you with, but we received an invitation by the Ministry of Culture in 2002 to conduct some field work in the Polisario controlled zones. So we're working in the Polisario areas, not Moroccan areas. Initially, this was to be essentially archaeological reconnaissance, focusing on mapping the stone monuments and the burials, the burial monuments and the tumuli. The project's been led by the University of East Anglia, with which I have links, but there's been a lot of input from other institutions, the University of Leicester in particular, for example. So we cooperate with the Polisario authorities. We've conducted 8 field seasons, as you'll see from the dates. We're on a bit of a hiatus at the moment, partly because of the sort of security situation in the region at large, although not, I hasten to add, in these areas that we've been working, but more in Mauritania and Algeria. Also, we've been busy, or not so busy recently, because of other responsibilities, trying to write up all the results of our fieldwork in a book, which we hope to have out this year, and so on. But we basically completed 8 field seasons between 2002 and 2009. We hope at some point to get back into the field for phase 2 of the project. So these field seasons have consisted of reconnaissance, where we're basically sort of seeing what's there, doing sort of non-invasive recording of sites in both an intensive and extensive manner. We've done more detailed survey. We have done a few excavations, which I'll talk about a little bit later. We've been looking at both the archaeology and also evidence of past environmental change, so we can hopefully sort of link these together and try and weave a narrative of how the changes that people saw in terms of their livelihoods and their culture, how that sort of fitted into a context of environmental change, which I'll also talk about in the following slides. So on the one hand, we want to just sort of generally increase our understanding of the archaeology and prehistory of Western Sahara, because very little has been done in that respect, with the exception of some work principally by Spanish teams who are focused largely on rock art. We also want to study human-environment interaction in the past and sort of compare the archaeology of Western Sahara with other adjacent regions and see how it fits into the wider sort of Saharan archaeological complex, if you like. And one of the things we've also been very aware of course, is the importance of the cultural heritage and trying to sort of raise awareness of that and actually get people to recognize that there is some really exciting stuff here. So on the map, we've just got marked the various places where we've done recording. So refer to these as sites recorded, but each site might consist of a lot of different, for example, burials or funerary complexes and so on, rock art sites. But this represents our sort of activity throughout both what we call the northern sector up here and the southern sector of the Polisario areas of Western Sahara.
Just get rid of that.
Yeah, of course, yeah. Google Hangouts, brilliant.
There you go.
Okay. That's better. So I'm going to say a little bit now about working in this sort of context of conflict. This is a rock shelter in the southern sector where we sort of spent a bit of time doing some survey. And the Arabic here says, Kul al-Watan al-Shahada, which means all the homeland or martyrdom. And that's quite a nice little summary of the context we're working in, where we have sort of a nationalist population who are very, very keen on regaining their homeland. So this is the context. Cultural context in which we overwhelmingly work. There are more practical considerations as well about working in Western Sahara, notably these particular field hazards, lots of ordnance from the conflict, some of which is spent, some of which isn't. These have been collected by Landmine Action, who have a presence in the Polisario areas in the, well, I guess we can call it the de facto capital, although it's pretty small place called Tiferiti. So we have all sorts of stuff, including cluster munitions, cluster bombs. So this isn't sort of ubiquitously spread throughout the entire areas we work, but you do find concentrations of it where there have been battles, and you do have to be very, very mindful of this sort of stuff. And we have actually abandoned surveys because we decided the risk is too high because of the increasing amounts of ordnance as we do our field walking. So, and I'll say more, I think, about the conflict when we talk about the cultural heritage as well. So let's talk now about the scientific contexts. What are the wider regional contexts in terms of the archaeology and the environment that we need to concern ourselves with? Well, Western Sahara is, although it's on the edge of the Sahara, it's still part of the Sahara. And the archaeological environmental context of the Sahara is very, very interesting. Despite being mostly arid to hyper-arid desert, the Sahara has an enormous amount of fascinating archaeology from a period when it was much, much wetter. There was, outside of the main sort of present-day urban centres, there was quite a denser than today occupation, human occupation from about 10,000 to 5,000 years ago, when the Sahara was not the desert that it is now. It was a humid to semi-arid environment, much of which would have resembled the East African savannas today. And we can see evidence of this in a lot of the rock art. This is just a very, very small scraping of the surface. Some very old engravings from southern Libya here. This is a hippopotamus, not the type of animal you expect to find in a hyper-arid environment today, obviously. And also from southern Libya, we have engravings of cattle up here. These sort of things are really, really common in the Sahara. You find engravings of cattle everywhere throughout the Sahara, indicating that it was once a much more productive environment. This is a pillar of lake sediment, again, from southern Libya, from somewhere that now has an average of something like 15 millimeters of rainfall every year. Some years it will have none at all. What this tells us is that, you know, this region has experienced profound changes over the millennia. This was once a lake. Now it's one of the driest places on Earth. So we have this very, very interesting context of profound and severe environmental change in the Saharan region as a whole. And this was largely due to a more intense monsoon that penetrated further north in the what we call the early Holocene, the period between about 10 and 5,000 years ago. People existed by hunting and gathering, and as time wore on, increasingly by cattle herding and so on. So the drying of the Sahara took place, well, over a long period, but there was a phase between about, we can say, probably 5,800 and 5,200 years ago, where this transition to desert really took off. This graphic up here shows the amount of dust, wind-blown dust, being deposited in a marine core, sediment core, in the eastern Atlantic. So the more dust we get blowing into the sea, the drier it is. Basically, it's a proxy, it's an indicator of aridity. The scale has been reversed here to make it look more dramatic, so that down means drier. But what we see is, again, between about 5,700 or 800 and 5,200, a massive increase in the amount of dust being blown off the Sahara as the vegetation basically dies back and the area becomes more arid. And we find a lot of poignant reminders of the human implications of this. This is, again, from southern Libya, and it's a grinding stone in somewhere where it wouldn't really be much to grind today. So, again, it tells us that once upon a time, this was a much more productive place. So how does Western Sahara fit in to this story, this narrative? Well, if you look at the sort of wider body of research over the last few decades, the answer is, well, we don't know, because very little's been done there. This is illustrated by this map, which shows the dates in 1,000 years before present of sites with recorded cattle remains. This is from a publication by a colleague called Helene Juice, who I've worked with in Western Sahara. And so we can see across North Africa and the Sahara, there are these dated sites where there are remains of cattle, most of which are domesticated. And in this, there's a big gap over sort of Western Sahara and the immediately adjacent regions. Now, this isn't because cattle didn't exist there. It isn't because people didn't herd cattle, as we can see from these paintings and engravings from Western Sahara itself. It's because there's been no archaeological work to speak of there, certainly in terms of looking at these types of sites or doing any dating. So there's a real gap in our knowledge here. It's an area that is, you know, to exaggerate a little bit, a blank space on the map in terms of our understanding of the archaeology. So it's a gap that we have over our, I guess, almost decade of work, which has consisted largely of short field seasons, as and when we can afford the time and the financial resources to get out there in quite a difficult context in terms of actually working. We've tried to sort of begin to fill that gap, or at least to flesh out what's been going on there. So one of the first things we wanted to do was to look at sort of the environmental context. In the rest of the Sahara, we have plenty of evidence of wetter conditions in the past. We have dry lake beds. We have evidence of river deposits and so on, as well as the pictures of hippos and cattle and so on. So in Western Sahara itself, we have similar sorts of things. We can use satellite imagery, for example, to identify lake surfaces, dry lake surfaces, where you have crusts of gypsum or carbonate. This is what this looks like on the ground. We have sort of organic deposits in caves and rock shelters. For example, we managed to get a date from one such deposit of about 6,000 BC, indicating that, you know, at this period, conditions were humid and we had sort of humid organic material being deposited in these caves and rock shelters. Sometimes we can find organic materials embedded in the lake sediments, for example, snail shells, which can often be dated quite successfully. We've had a date of 4,500 years ago. So I'm mixing up my years before present and BC here a little bit. Freshwater snail shells saying that at least in this particular lake, there was still fresh water there 4,500 years ago, a little bit later than in much of the rest of the Sahara. So we can use satellite imagery to identify these sites of interest, go out into the field and see if there's anything we can use sort of radiometric dating on to tell us when it was wet. little typo in my title here, please see earlier lakes, it should say. We have a lot of lake deposits that are very old, from Pleistocene period, which is the period between about 3 million years ago and about 10,000 years ago. And a lot of these, probably most of them, will date from the last interglacial period, about 110,000 to 15,000 years ago. This is one such example of a paleo lake from the last interglacial. Very, very thick deposits, several meters, in fact. And around it, we find evidence of, we can say human occupation, but some of the technologies represented are very, very old, so we're not necessarily talking about Homo sapiens here. So what we tend to find is around the lake deposits, we do find evidence of human occupation in the form of, in this case, very, very ancient technologies. For example, we have Acheulean hand axes here, which date back sort of hundreds and hundreds of thousands of years. And some of the more recent ones, we have Neolithic materials and pottery as well, obviously. So we have these very, very old lake deposits, but we also have much more recent deposits. We have Holocene deposits, last 10,000 years, in the form of carbonate deposits, for example, springline deposits in caves. When I say deposits, we've only identified one. This is one of the problems about working in Western Sahara, is that the environmental evidence is quite sparse. While there are these sort of playa surfaces where you've had a lot of ephemeral drainage washing in sort of silt and sediment, there's not a lot you can date there, and a lot of them are still active as well. So you'd have to do some very, very deep cores to get much out of them. So compared with some of the other parts of the Sahara that people are working in, the environmental evidence is quite sparse. But we lucked out here. We found some springline deposits, mineralized carbonates that included fragments of desert grasses that are often used for grazing and fodder, suggesting that maybe we had some cattle herding going on here. Fragments of pottery and grinding stone, datable organic materials, mammal bones, possible mineralized fish vertebrae, and also a dated stone from woolly African savanna species dated to about, to the middle of the 4th millennium BC. So suggesting that, you know, between about 3 and 4,000 BC, we did have this humid environment. People were around here, animals were around, and we had probably things like cattle herding going on during this period. We've got other evidence. The only other sort of bona fide Holocene paleo lake that we found is in the far south of Western Sahara, a place called Mouilhet Awadi, And again, here we have some good thick deposits with organic materials in. And we've done some preliminary dating on the samples that we managed to export via Algeria, not always the easiest task. But again, suggests that we have a similar thing going on here, sort of a wet early Holocene 10 to 5,000 years ago, like we have in much of the rest of the Sahara. So broadly speaking, in terms of the environmental evidence, the suggestions are that what's going on in Western Sahara reflects what's going on in the Sahara at large, a wet episode between 5 and 10,000 years ago, possibly lasting longer in Western Sahara than elsewhere. So in terms of the archaeological record itself, we've already seen one or two examples of some of the worked stone, but we have a lot of stuff there. And of course, the joys of working in the desert is that you don't really have to dig for anything. Well, occasionally you do, but the deflation of the surface by the wind means that you have relatively recent materials sitting next to very, very ancient materials. So all you have to do is, if you're so inclined, pick it up and put it back, obviously. So we have a lot of very ancient worked stone from the Paleolithic. We also have a lot of pottery, particularly in the southern regions from the last 10,000 years or so. And again, this is something that we want to do more work on in terms of dating, but as I alluded to earlier, exporting stuff from Algeria is problematic, so it's a bit hit and miss. But probably the most visible expression of the archaeological record, of the prehistoric material heritage, is the huge diversity and number of stone structures that we have there. We've had a lot of discussions about what we call these. Do we call them burials? Do we call them monuments? Do we call them stone structures? We decided to call them stone structures because some of them may not have been monumental, they may have been more practical. Not all of them are going to be burials and so on. But across the whole area that we've worked in, we find tumuli, more exotic stone monumental structures, other stone structures that, as I said, may have been had practical purposes, such as navigation and standing stones. We have some quite spectacular rock art. This is an open air site where we have engraved panels just sort of exposed to the elements at a place called Slagir in the northern sector. I don't know whether we want to get into discussion of interpreting rock art. It's something that, particularly in the Sahara, has, I think, been not overlooked in terms of its spectacular characteristics, but overlooked in terms of actually any sort of meaningful interpretation in a lot of cases. Certainly we can say that certain animals feature very, very prominently in Sahara.
These two big round bits, kind of in the center.
This bit here.
Are those functional, like, grinding things?
I think looking at those, they're probably just water erosion where you've got a little indentation and you've got rainfall pooling and dissolving the rock away. We have got lots of evidence, lots of examples of grinding hollows in the stones. I'm not sure if there are any in the slides here, but yeah, they're certainly there in abundance, particularly in the south. But I think not so in this case.
How big are those?
Yes, I should have a scale on there, really. So this panel is probably about, a meter from here to the end, maybe a little less. Yes, I don't always remember to use my portable scale as I should. As well as engravings, we have quite an abundance of paintings. Can we see?
Sometimes the paintings don't. That's brilliant. Yeah, that's not bad, actually. So,
quite a number of assemblages of rock paintings. This is the site that I won't say discovered because I don't like the word, we identified. In fact, our Sahrawi cook identified it. It's very important to get that in 2002 during our first field season. Again, what we have here is, I could talk a bit more about this particular site. But on this panel, we have an assemblage of wild fauna. We have some handprints up here. We have other recesses where you have a focus on just domestic animals. You have other recesses where they're just people depicted. So there appears to be quite a division in terms of the way the surfaces were used. Some panels or recesses were used to depict certain themes and others were used to depict others. So it's not just a random mishmash of people drawing whatever they fancy. But no doubt there are more of these sites to be discovered there as well. Just a few more examples, more giraffes. And what we find, we saw it on the last giraffe engraving, is that we often have these sort of strange
appendages coming out of the giraffes, which some people have said, oh, are they reins or tethers? And I don't think people were tethering giraffes. I think it's probably something a little bit more symbolic. But in Southern African rock art, I know giraffe have often been associated with rain. You sometimes see sort of lines coming out of the mouth that are some people have interpreted as representing drinking or water or so on. Endless speculation about the meanings of rock art is possible. So throughout our, particularly the last part of our field season, we focused on an intensive survey in a particular area north of the settlement of Tifariti, which is the largest settlement in the Polisario controlled areas. So it just gives you some sort of idea of the density of sites, of monuments, of stone structures, whatever we want to call them. So this is an area of 9.5 square kilometres, and we've recorded 411 stone structures here. Mostly likely to be burials and related monuments, almost overwhelmingly in this case. There's also worked stone present there, and based on the type of materials that we're seeing there in comparison with other regions in the Sahara, where we've had datings, it looks like there was occupation in this area between about 8 and 10,000 years ago, and then a gap for maybe several centuries or a millennia from about 8,000 years ago. Interestingly, this hiatus, or at least the beginning of the hiatus, coincides with a widespread episode of sort of severe climatic change. There was a cool arid episode around about 8.2 thousand years ago that persisted for several centuries. And this shows up in a lot of environmental and archaeological records, particularly in the drier parts of the Northern Hemisphere. After this period, there was some reoccupation. We don't have a direct dating, but what we do know from comparison with other Saharan regions is that these stone structures, the monuments, the monumental burials, seem to have spread throughout the Sahara from the east to the west, or the center to the west, with the spread of cattle herding. And by looking at the dates of the spread of cattle herding, we expect that these probably date to after about 6,000 years ago. What we suspect was happening here was that we had an in-migration of cattle herders as cattle herding spread from the east to the west throughout the Sahara. And there's a question here that if we are seeing sort of people coming into this area, were they sort of fleeing the aridity in the more inland areas? Was Western Sahara a bit of a refuge for people fleeing or moving away from the desertification of the Sahara as a whole? In terms of the actual monuments that we see, there's an enormous diversity of types. There are many more actually than we've got depicted here. We've got the classic tumuli, the sort of conical tumuli that I'm sure you're all familiar with. We also have lots of other weird and wonderful structures. We have platform tumuli up here, which is basically a normal tumulus on a sort of paved area. We have what are referred to as basina, which is sort of dry stone wall, type of flatter rocks used in the construction. We have sort of V-types, crescent-shaped, sort of crescents that are actually sort of wide paved areas that we call arched platforms. So many, many different types. Some of these are reflective of the types of monuments we see across the Sahara at large. Others seem to be much more distinctive and specific to the western regions of the Sahara, or even possibly to Western Sahara itself. Just as an example of this, there's it's a bit of a fuzzy image, apologies for that. But this is a monument called a goulet, or an enclosure monument. And the form that this takes is sort of a circular feature at one end, which may be paved or it may be sort of open like this. There may be a small tumulus in the middle here, usually quite low. And then extending away from this, we have these sort of arced enclosures, almost like wings, that sort of form this sort of shape here. And running away from the central tumulus, a double line of stones forming a sort of a corridor or a gully, hence the French name goulet. And this is a type of monument that's not particularly widespread. This is the distribution of goulet monuments that have been recorded that we know about in the entire Sahara. It's a particular sort of western form, extends into some examples, I think two in Algeria, a few in Mauritania, many more in Morocco, but it clusters around here. So we're talking about a sort of regionally distinct form that isn't found in the more central regions of the Sahara. The most southerly example is one that we found here in the southern parts of the areas we've been working in, and this appears to be quite anomalous. We haven't found any in the intervening regions. we've got a much less colourful map here of what we've referred to as complex monuments. And so far, they've only been recorded in the northern hemisphere of Western Sahara, although there may be, from descriptions that I've heard, some in southern Morocco. Just to show you the format of a complex monument, this sort of tumulus here with a square enclosure and then a sort of V-type or hemispheric or semicircular enclosure here and a couple of arms. So quite a sort of, we didn't know what to call it, so it's quite complex, isn't it? Let's call it a complex monument. But this is quite interesting because it suggests that we had specific things going on with the development of these sort of stone structures in Western Sahara compared to other regions. So here are some pretty pictures basically to illustrate some of these. This is a complex monument on the ground. This is a corbeille monument, again, sort of French terminology, sort of slightly out-angled flat stones in a circular shape looking like a basket. This is part of a very, very large Goulet monument, the largest one, as far as we're aware, that's been recorded anywhere in the Tifriti area, in our intensive survey area, aligned on the flat-topped hill facing directly west. Something else we find with a lot of the monuments is that they're quite concerned with geographical alignments or even astronomical alignments. Another example of that here, this is a sort of fairly bog standard tumulus, conical or flat top tumulus, but associated with quite a number of standing stones and also with some sort of alignment here. What we have is standing stones more or less aligned with what we refer to as an annex, a sort of little false entrance, like a sort of symbolic doorway, that in this case is constructed from two big sort of slabs and a pink granite grinding stone here. So again, something that's quite common is these sort of collections of standing stones aligned with various features on the main structures. Again, assemblages of standing stones are found throughout Western Sahara. Sometimes we see individual standing stones, but in other instances, we find a collection of things, about 65 in this one. And again, this is our main intensive survey area. Some of these alignments, again, are directly north-south or east-west. This particular one is open towards the east. There's a lot of quartz that's been deliberately placed within the assemblage of standing stones as well. Quartz widely associated, as I'm sure most of you know, throughout the world with burials and rituals surrounding death. And actually, if we look at the wider area here, this sits at the center of a bowl-like depression around which are a lot of other monuments, a lot of which seems to align on this location. In 2005, we did excavate a couple of these monuments, or test excavations. So these were two fairly regular-type tumuli, again, in the Tifriti area. We found in one of them pretty well-preserved human remains, and the other just sort of fragments, nothing really left. Very well constructed burial chambers here. So we're not just talking about piles of stones on top of bodies. We're talking about a very, very sort of sophisticated construction for the burial chamber to protect the body and then capped and covered over with stones. A few grave goods, not many in here, suggesting again, not a particularly materialistic sort of culture as we'd expect, but you know, the type of things you might expect to find in a pastoralist burial, a few small ornaments, fragments of pottery, interestingly an iron point, which means that we're talking about quite a late date here, a copper earring and some ostrich eggshell beads and some drilled shells, which would have come from the West African coast. So again, this tells us something about the connection of the people buried here with the surrounding regions. And we got some radiocarbon dates, which at first we didn't really trust, so we did it again and found we had the same sort of dates coming out. And these are from essentially the period between about 1 and 600 AD. So what we've got here is essentially prehistoric Saharan burial monuments built in the historical period. And again, that's really, really interesting. I think, although in the central Sahara we find prehistoric style burials going up into sort of the third millennium before present, I'm not sure we have any as late as this. So this suggests that this sort of prehistoric cultural complex was existing here a lot later, much, much later, millennia later than many other parts of the Sahara. Again, suggesting that we might be looking at somewhere that was a sort of a final redoubt for prehistoric populations as the Sahara dried up. Away from our main intensive study area in Tiferiti. We have, again, lots of examples of weird and wonderful types of monuments. There are very, very large tumuli here. We found about six of these all told, so not many, but really, really quite sort of spectacularly big compared to most of the tumuli that we find. Something we found in 2009 that we were quite excited about, or maybe you think we were just seeing things, I don't know, I'd be interested to hear people's views. We recorded a large, not the largest, but a largish Goulet structure, and lots of quartz here, lots of sort of different coloured stones. Within the arms, we sort of found these structures, which we think are sort of essentially mosaic type structures representing animals, possibly cattle. Again, maybe you think this is really the Eye of Faith here, but we can see in this one a sort of zoomorphic type shape, possibly a couple of legs down here. There's obviously been an effort to put a lot of stones densely packed in this middle area here. So this has been, these have been deliberately placed. In this one here, it's more of an outline. We think this could be representative of a cow. I don't know, can anybody else see that? Or do you think I'm completely mad? So just above center to the left, we think there's a head here, legs sort of down below, and we have a sort of outline here of something, again, that looks somewhat zoomorphic. So we haven't heard of anything like this anywhere else in the Sahara. So again, this is something that if our interpretation is correct, looks to be pretty unique. So a few more examples from the southern sector. Some of these images are not that sharp. That's got kind of massive file. So I did a sort of reduced file size by sort of resampling the resolution of the images. And I think that might have been a mistake, but at least it meant it didn't crash anymore. Anyway, so in the southern sector is some examples of the types of stone structures we find there. This is what we call Crescent Monument. So we have a sort of an elongated central tumulus here, and then arms that sort of curve out and back on themselves, like so. And these can be absolutely enormous. There's one, here's an example of one. This is just a little bit of one arm of one monument. This isn't the central tumulus, this is just a sort of auxiliary tumulus built on the arm. And I think that it's like several hundred meters between the ends of the arms here. So some of these are really enormous monumental structures. Other types of structures we find are these sort of weird ones that have sort of a winding, sort of sinuous line of sort of not quite vertical but flatty stones emanating from a central tumulus. And again, these seem quite unique to Western Sahara in terms of what we know about the Saharan monuments. Seeing that one. And again, the ubiquitous conical tumuli, but when we get into the south, some of these become absolutely enormous. In fact, on a sort of sandstormy day when visibility was poor, we thought we'd driven up a small rise or a hill. We realized we'd actually driven up onto the top of a massive tumulus with lots of other tumuli built on top of it, and so on. So again, we're talking about really, really monumental structures here. I've already mentioned that a lot of these are associated with standing stones and alignments. I think this one, if I recall correctly, is a north-south alignment. So what we did is we actually, for the monuments that we could define an alignment for example, the Crescent monuments, we define an alignment as basically aligned bisecting the angle sort of made by the arms. We've got this down here. And for the tumuli that were associated with standing stones or alignments, we plotted the alignments defined thus. What we find is that overwhelmingly, they tend to sort of all be aligned towards the east. This is with the Crescent monuments. We have a much more tight clustering. And actually, a colleague of ours who's worked with us in the region, who is much more expert on astronomical alignments than I am, says that what we're seeing here is that most of these alignments are within the angle bracketed by the positions, the extreme positions of the rising sun, but actually more so the rising and setting of the moon. So it seems that a lot of what's going on here is astronomical alignments that might be used to, much as we have sort of in the British Isles, to, you know, line up with the rising sun or the setting sun or the rising or setting moon on particular days of the year. So this brings us to this a bit more speculation. We've been wondering lately
whether there might be some links, as well as with the Central Sahara, with sort of the Atlantic Europe sort of seaboard. And it sounds a bit sort of fanciful at first, and we were a bit, I wonder. But actually, I think the Belbika culture, for example, has its origins, or the earliest sites are actually in northern Morocco. So there are already connections between Northwest Africa and Europe in the prehistoric period. And what we find in Western Sahara is a lot of traits in the rock art and also in the stone structures that aren't particularly common, or that are more or less absent in the Central Sahara, but that we see in Atlantic Europe. These are things like the widespread use of quartz. Now, quartz is used all over the world, so that in itself is nothing special. But the fact that we don't see much of this in other parts of the Sahara is significant, and that we do see a lot of it in Europe. The use of sort of curbing to define the perimeters of monuments, again, something we see a lot in Europe. We don't see much of this in the Central Sahara, so a different construction style, more like what we see in Europe. In terms of the rock art, again, spiral motifs are found pretty much everywhere you want to look at rock engravings, so in themselves, they're not particularly spectacular. But again, they're not that common in the Central Sahara. In fact, I don't have any in the Central Sahara. What we do find is that these tend to be quite common along the waterways, the wadi systems that drain down to the Atlantic. That would have been, if you wanted to have a connection between the Atlantic coast and the interior, these would have been the routes you'd have to take because of the nature of the geography. So again, suggesting, well, is this because there was some connection, and are we seeing the transmission or of these ideas along these particular routeways? Because they do seem to be focused along those potential mobility corridors. So, you know, pretty speculative at the moment. We wouldn't make any great claims, but we think this is something worth investigating. And if we manage to get back into the field in the foreseeable future, then we want to do a lot more mapping of these types of traits and a lot more investigation to see what really is going on here.
Are you finding any Mon collar boards?
Any
Mon collar boards? They're cupules. They're two aligned, maybe like 8 to 10 cupules long, and there's two, and it's a gang, and it was
okay.
That you trace along water routes to traders.
Okay. We haven't found any of those there. I have seen something similar in Libya, actually. I think sort of two lines of little small hollows about that size of a big marble, about 6 on each, yeah. So we've seen them in Libya. We haven't seen them here yet. So, but as you think about what we've seen in the burials, then there obviously were links with the Atlantic. Where did they get the shells from? And also probably with other inland regions as well. So trying to sort of summarize what some of these stone structures tell us, they suggest that we are seeing differences between the northern and southern parts of the areas we're working in. So we have the monument distribution suggesting that there are probably different cultural trajectories going on in the northern southern sectors. Maybe different populations, maybe stuff going on at different times, maybe the focus of activity was in the north in one period and the south in another period, who knows. We have a lot of similarities with the Central Sahara, indicating that there was a connection with the wider prehistoric Saharan cultural complex. But we also have these distinct forms and features in the stone structures that suggest there was some sort of divergence. You know, these are different things that we're not seeing elsewhere, at least in the Sahara. And I wonder if what was going on here is you have populations coming from the more central regions. We know that the Central Sahara dried up earlier than the western regions from environmental dating evidence. Could it be that people are bringing their architectural techniques with them and building these funerary monuments, but then after they've been there for some time, they're developing new ones. So this is something we'd like to test by seeing whether the more regionally specific monument types are actually much more recent. Unfortunately, that means digging up a lot of burials and doing a lot of dating, which is quite difficult for the practical reasons I've spoken about. We have seen one or two examples where we have, for example, a complex monument built on top of a crescent monument. So telling us that at least in that instance, the one was later than the other. So, you know, there are suggestions there. The very late ages of the burials at Tifereti suggests, again, that this area was occupied a lot later than inland regions of the Sahara to the east. So, again, suggesting or providing further support to the theory that we have a later transition to aridity and this area acted as a refuge. And again, we can also look at the climate today. Today, Western Sahara is much, much wetter than the further easterly inland regions of the Sahara.
So if that's something that pertained in the past, then that idea does make more sense as well. We've also seen suggestions of tantalizing, tentative, speculative suggestions of possible links with Atlantic Europe, that if they did exist, were probably via mobility up and down the east-west oriented wadi systems that drain into the Atlantic. This is speculative, but it's something we want to investigate further. This idea that Western Sahara was a refuge, again, as I said, supported by the fact it is much wetter today than further easterly regions. For example, we see that after rainfall, people dig down to access the elevated water table in the wadi systems, and we can also see quite abundant vegetation here. And certainly if you go there after rainfall, then it does resemble a savanna just without the animals. So certainly you get the impression today of somewhere that is significantly more humid than you might expect it to be given its location and latitude. Oops, that's a wrong heading. That should say archaeology, cultural heritage, and conflict. So I've sort of tried to give you a summary, a bit of a vague whistle-stop tour of the type of things we're finding, what they might mean in terms of interpreting the archaeological record in the absence of large numbers of radiocarbon dates, and so on. But I know that some of you here are interested in the cultural heritage aspects of our work, not just in terms of the archaeology itself, but what's going on in terms of how the archaeology is perceived, how it's used, how it relates to the conflict, the ongoing political conflict between the Polisario and Morocco. So to start off with, conflict has been a bit of a mixed blessing for the archaeology. There is an argument that to a certain extent, the fact that you've had the conflict there that has kept people away, apart from the protagonists in the conflict, obviously, has actually served to protect some of the archaeological sites. We haven't had mass tourism here that we've seen in a lot of other parts of the Sahara, particularly in places like Algeria and Libya, where tourism has actually done a lot of damage, whether it's people splashing water over rock paintings to make them stand out better for their photographs, or whether it's people picking up stone tools as souvenirs and basically sterilizing entire landscapes of the archaeological record. We haven't had that since the colonial period here. Certainly, Spanish archaeologists did a lot of work there during the colonial period, in the days before there was widespread use of radiocarbon dating. So, you know, they were largely focused on sort of collecting and describing, and certainly a lot of stuff was gathered up, although probably that was more focused in the areas that are now under Moroccan control, just because of accessibility issues. But the conflict has, you know, to a certain extent, protected the region from tourists and looters and so on. And you find some archaeological sites that have been in the middle of you know, specifically intense conflict situations in Western Sahara that are surprisingly well preserved, that they haven't been completely sort of annihilated or defaced or whatever. But having said that, obviously the flip side is that conflict itself does bring direct risks. Where you have a bombardment, obviously the archaeology may well be damaged. Military vehicles, heavy vehicles are likely to do damage, particularly to some of these sort of very low-lying monuments. We saw the goulets earlier, for example. They're very difficult to spot until you're upon them. So certainly some of them have been driven over quite extensively. But we also see much more direct damage to sites. This is, as far as we can tell, given the context and the sort of stones that we're seeing here, is essentially a burial tumulus that appears to be reworked as a gun emplacement. And we see a number of these, and particularly around Tiferiti, we have earthworks in the form of quite intensive trenching done by the Moroccans when they were defending Tiferiti in areas that have got a high density of monuments. So we know that a lot of these have been directly damaged and deliberately modified for defensive use. Of course, the other thing about conflict is that not a lot gets done when there's an active conflict or a frozen conflict in terms of initiatives to preserve and conserve the archaeology. Certainly, Polisario have been very keen on getting UNESCO involved in declaring certain areas as sites of world heritage or other initiatives to declare them sites of special interest. But most international organizations are very loath to get involved in Western Sahara because of the conflict. In the case of UNESCO, I think they have 6 or 7 World Heritage Sites in Morocco as well, so they have a vested interest in not upsetting Morocco, which they would if they started working with Polisario. So So there are things that can't be done or that aren't being done as a result of the conflict, even though it's now a cold rather than a hot conflict. And the other thing that I'll talk about in a bit more detail is the deliberate vandalism or degradation of sites by military personnel themselves. So this is a good place to introduce these rather upsetting images, particularly when you know what's underneath this graffiti here. You always find a bit of graffiti in rock art sites, and throughout Western Sahara in the decorated shelters, we do find a bit of historical graffiti, some in Arabic, some in English, some in, well, not much in English, some in Spanish, and some of it certainly dates from well before the 70s. But there was a particularly notable episode of vandalism in 2006 when UN peacekeepers from one of the bases in the Polisario areas basically took themselves up to this site, which does house quite a number of engravings and very faint paintings, and decided to use acrylic spray paint to record their presence there. So they signed their names, their nationalities, some of them gave their staff numbers, and also sort of the dates that they were there and where they were based. I think these were from Agwenit base. Yeah, AIU was the code for Agwenit. So this happened in 2006. A German colleague of mine actually went out on a reconnaissance trip in late 2006 and spotted this and tried to sort of raise awareness of it. And I didn't get very far because it was published in German language newspapers. The Polisario complained to the United Nations about the graffiti at this particular site called Lajuad in the south. This is the cave here where we're seeing this graffiti. In fact, you're asking about the grinding hollows. There are a lot of grinding hollows in the floor of this cave here. I think maybe just about see some. There's one here, some along here as well. The lots of remnants of rock paintings and also engravings here. On the floor, there are paintings of sort of human figures, engravings of feet with toes and all sorts of things there. And the Spanish team who have done work at this site have taken some really quite spectacular images of the engravings and paintings under particular light conditions and using sort of fancy techniques that do illustrate that this is quite an important site. But these UN peacekeepers didn't really pay much attention to that and just decided to go and deface it. So we visited Lajuad in 2007, the second time I'd been there, and the previous occasion was 2000. Old, sort of quite low-level graffiti. And it's quite shocking to sort of find this. Sort of zoom in on some of them. So we've got Evgeny from Russia. He was there, I think, the 7th, July 2006, based at Agwenit. So quite easy to identify the culprits. There you go. Here's another one. August the 12th, 2007. So I was getting through Ahmed from Egypt and so on. Some from Croatia, some presumably from Russia. Okay, so that's the stuff at Agwenit. Actually, I don't think I've got the slide here. But we later found, or somebody found online, that Ahmed from Egypt had conducted a ethics in peacekeeping course, so which was quite amazing. And we actually can see underneath here, you can see remnants again, and not very clear on the big screen, remnants of sort of wavy line engravings on the back here. There's some older Arabic graffiti here. There's actually, this is a parachute sort of that's been scratched in probably, from quite some decades previously. And again, some modern graffiti back here. So to give you some idea of the scale, some of these are about sort of meter or so tall. But as I said, we discovered this sort of stuff, and also some vandalism was another site in the north, not quite as impressive in terms of the use of spray paint, but also, again, some of them with some staff numbers that we think were from the Minurso peacekeeping forces, but also graffiti from local people in the form of apparently some very, as my role interpreted, some very bad things written in Arabic there. So after this trip in 2007, particularly after viewing the damage at Lajuad, I came back and I thought, this isn't really on, and people had complained to the UN, nothing had happened.
So through the UEA press office, we managed to get a story in the Times, basically describing this UN vandal spray graffiti on Saharan's prehistoric rock art. And again, this was picked up by the BBC, Peacekeepers Defaced Ancient Art. And it became, for a little while, something that was, you know, certainly within the field of sort of archaeology in the Sahara and Western Sahara, quite prominent. And so I did a few sort of interviews and so on. And as a result of this, there was a bit of, I mean, we had also complained to Minerso ourselves first and hadn't really got much response. It was only when the media got involved that they made some declarations that they were going to sort of set it right, and they were looking at how they'd restore the sites and so on. They were going to discipline the people responsible and what have you. So in the end, there was an effort to try and restore the sites. I did see one of them, the one with the paintings and the sort of not with the spray paint. And it seemed to have restored, you know, relatively well, but you're not going to restore the status quo ante in any of these cases. But what was really interesting was what sort of followed in terms of the politics of the local protagonists to the conflict, as well as the UN. When we went back in 2008, at one of the sites, the site in the north, we found that the United Nations put up this sign, which I'm sure you can all read. This is a cultural heritage site. It's important to humankind and is to be protected and preserved for future generations. Please treat it with respect. This is one of the sites that they vandalised. So the UN obviously felt it necessary to basically put this very public warning up to their staff and also publicly sort of demonstrate they were taking it seriously by installing this sign. I suspect probably goes back to the colonial period, so maybe to the 40s or 30s or 40s even. It's not all by foreigners. There are some bits is done by local people. But I know it's only in Egypt it goes back sort of centuries, doesn't it? So millennia even. But I think as long as people are visiting these sorts of areas, some of them will be tempted to leave their mark there. From what we've seen, like the parachute, for example, I don't know when that dates from, but maybe from the last war or something. So, so yeah, maybe half a century or something. So, of course, some people say, well, this is also rock art. So you get into this whole sort of discussion of what's legitimate. Was the original rock art just vandalism and graffiti and so on? So, anyway, so this is the UN sign. But what was interesting was that after they put that up, the Polisario, the local, the sort of self-declared government of the Sahrawi Arab Democratic Republic, also put up a sign. And so I think what we had is this sort of ownership battle over who's sort of taking responsibility for the cultural heritage. And this is where it gets really interesting, I think, because the UN, they can't, but they don't like to be seen to be cooperating with the Polisario. They don't, technically, they shouldn't really cooperate with one side or the other, but with both. And I know that Morocco is very, very keen on trying to delegitimize the Polisario as a national government or a national movement even. And so whenever the UN looked like they might be taking them seriously or you know, cooperating or collaborating with them, Morocco complains. So what the UN tend to do here is they do things unilaterally. So, you know, as far as we were informed, they just put this up. They didn't sort of ask anybody or whatever, the previous one rather. So, of course, this put Polisario's nose out of joint because they're saying, well, basically the UN is declaring this site a special, you know, site of interest, site of cultural heritage on their own without consulting us. So they decided to declare the whole area around this site of Rakeslem Gassem as a national archaeological park. And again, this is a very, very good outcome, I think, a very sort of noble effort. And when I returned in 2009, I found that rather than just being able to wander around at will and look at the rock paintings, you had to be checked in at a checkpoint and then someone accompanied you. So actually, there were real efforts there to make sure that, that the process of people visiting the site was managed well, which was great. This all stemmed from this vandalism by the UN and then the subsequent sort of battle over ownership. And I think what was also interesting was that the Sahrawi are not very keen on the UN. As far as they're concerned, they haven't really done very much apart from sit there, freeze the conflict, allow Morocco to consolidate its military position, put a load of settlers in the territory it occupies, and they've singularly and most spectacularly and most significantly failed to organise the referendum. So the UN aren't popular there, and so this became a stick to beat the UN with. So these useless Minurso peacekeepers, they're not doing anything, as somebody commented on a blog post I wrote about it. Now we know what the UN have been doing there. We thought it was nothing, but actually it's worse than nothing. So this was a sort of attitude. So as a result of this, people became very interested in the rock art and in the cultural heritage. People who previously didn't care at all about the cultural heritage amongst the Sahrawi were saying, these bastards have destroyed our heritage. They've attacked our cultural heritage. So suddenly they were interested in it. They had a sense of ownership of it because of what had happened. And I think that maybe isn't a direct consequence, but certainly the Ministry of Culture became much more proactive in terms of declaring an archaeological law. So they now have a law about how archaeological sites should be treated. They even decide, after we'd done our excavations in 2005, they then decided that actually no more excavations, because this is, you know, sensitive heritage. We don't want people just going and digging up the dead. Previously, the attitude had been, these prehistoric people buried in these tumuli are people before us. This term people before us is something that crops up quite often. And they were sort of pre-Islamic, they're pre-Sahrawi, so they didn't care. And now there's much more sensitivity about, you know, excavation of burial sites, which is certainly their call to make. And so again, not just more ownership over the cultural heritage, but also suggestions that there may be more identification with the prehistoric populations as well. Of course, then it's possible that that gets caught up with the heady sort of sense of nationalism as well. Certainly Morocco has not been above using archaeology to try and legitimize its claim to Western Sahara. After we'd done our first field season, there was a very strange article that cropped up in a Moroccan paper about how Moroccan archaeologists had discovered a 15,000-year-old Berber town in Western Sahara and the occupied areas. And so there are a lot of efforts here to sort of link current Moroccan culture with this very, very ancient town that apparently had places of worship. It's all nonsense. It's probably a sort of rock art site with some monuments and so on. So certainly this sort of effort to take ownership over the heritage has been part of the political conflict. What we saw again after the Minurso vandalism episode was the manifestation of this battle, and the Sahrawi, the Polisario, obviously making noises about it. But what was interesting was that the way it was covered as a result of our intervention was it was a story about Western Sahara that didn't mention Morocco. It didn't mention the conflict. It just mentioned Western Sahara. It talked, I think, about the Sahrawi government, and it talked about damage by UN peacekeepers. So Morocco was upset about that, and it then had to put its own complaint in to the UN about this vandalism of archaeological sites in Morocco, as they see it. So again, you had a bit of a tug of war there. So this continued actually in 2010. We saw more manifestations of how archaeology was basically being co-opted into the political conflict in the form of a meeting about cultural heritage that was held in the town of Smara, the city of Smara, which is one of the most significant population that is in Western Sahara, that's in the area occupied by Morocco. So it's basically a meeting about cultural heritage in the Sahara, held in an occupied city by the occupier, but also co-organized by the Trust for African Rock Art, who some of you may have heard of. Basically a sort of charitable trust that serves to raise awareness of and help to protect rock art in Africa, particularly in places like the Sahara. And so I had some conversations with Tara, and they said, oh, well, we're not interested in politics. We're just, sort of interested in preserving the heritage. And we didn't really know what the agenda was here and blah, 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 which I thought was a fairly sort of lame excuse, really. By participating with Morocco, you are essentially taking sides. You're legitimizing one side in the conflict. We've done that by working with the Polisario, but they're not the occupier, would be our response. So that was quite interesting. And some of the people who had been at the meeting did then sort of later communicate to me that they'd felt quite uneasy. They weren't really aware of the context. When they got there, it all seemed a little bit strange, and sort of the presence of all these military personnel seemed a bit odd at a
conference on rock art and so on. So this sort of seems to be, certainly in the early sort of 2010s, it was continuing this process by which cultural heritage had been co-opted into the conflict and was now something over which the two sides were effectively fighting and arguing, whereas previously, before there'd been much archaeological research and before there'd been any vandalism, it wasn't really something that figured at all. So I'm going to wind this up there. I'll just highlight, if anybody's interested in sort of finding out more about the project, there are a few publications out already. We have, I think, there's something we get off the top there. I know. So as I said earlier, we hope to actually have a book out, basically synthesizing all of our findings, which will do a much more coherent job than I've done this evening, I'm sure, in sort of setting out the conclusions and summarizing our work there. We hope that'll be out later this year. But in the meantime, we have a paper on antiquity from 2009, some earlier papers that are much more sort of like field reports, really. We also have a project website, which is in sore need of updating and refreshing. You can browse some of the images from the field work on Flickr. There's an address here. You could follow us on Facebook and Twitter as well, if you like. If you're interested in the rock art and the vandalism, the sort of that sort of issue, then again, I haven't been very active since I haven't been to the region for some time. But I was writing a blog that talked a lot about the politics there, but also has a lot of entries about the whole vandalism episode. So sort of the primary source if you're interested in sort of seeing what happened, talking about our experiences of dealing with NERSO and the response by the media and the consequences of that. And you can find that at sandanddust.wordpress.com. So there's a few resources there if you are interested in pursuing any of this a bit more. So finally, I need to say thank you to you for suffering me, for listening, turning up. But also it's worth mentioning some other people who I need to say thank you to. Obviously, I need to thank the government of the Sahrawi Arab Democratic Republic and the Polisario, who have basically helped us with logistical support and allowed us into the territory they control. The project's been funded by a number of sources. We've had small grants from the British Academy, University of Edinburgh, from an outfit called OFIT Energy, who for a while were active there. But a lot of the field seasons we funded by taking paying volunteers as well, which is a model we found when money was in short supply and you're working in an area that a lot of people don't want to touch, you have to resort to these sorts of methods. But it was quite successful. And I think if we go back into the field, that's a model we'll actually revive and sort of try and use to fund some sort of relatively low-cost survey field seasons. And then the list of other people and individuals who we need to thank, team members and so on. When it came to the vandalism and publicising that and actually responding to that, we collaborated quite heavily with Joachim Soller from the University of Girona. So that's it. Thank you for turning up. Thank you for listening to me. I'm very happy to take questions. I think we have quite some time yet here or in the pub or whatever. But if anybody wants to know more or wants me to clarify anything that I haven't been particularly coherent about, then feel free to raise your hand or just butt in.
It's a brilliant lecture, Nick. The scope and breadth of your work is outstanding, really.
That's very flattering. I felt a little incoherent, sir.
Absolutely not. Questions and comments and contributions?
I've battered you all senseless.
What's it to Woolly?
Sorry?
What's it to
Woolly? Oh, sorry, Tumulus. Okay. It's just Tumulus is fairly, well, there are probably proper archaeologists in the review give you a better answer, but it's essentially a generic term for a burial monument that's usually sort of conical or rounded in form. So the types of burial monuments that you'll find in the British Isles, in Ireland, in the southwest, the barrows and so on. Looks like a pile of stones, more sophisticated structure inside with the burial chamber, I describe lots of different types of monuments or stone structures, and some people refer to them all as tumuli. We use the term tumulus to refer to these, basically. So this is your classic tumulus shape. So yeah, generic term for a stone burial, effectively. Oh, people have come to, brilliant. Okay.
Catherine. Yeah, hi. So I was thinking about the context of the political conflict, yeah. And thinking back to a yours seminar that we had last term with a gentleman from Norwegian Institute. Mm. Basically, he was working on a site in Armenia.
Okay. Yeah.
And I think it was the Turkish authorities and the Armenians.
Yeah.
And at that talk, Carson, I think his name was basically trying to involve the community, but by taking a really distant sort of objective archaeological position. Whereas, I mean, I wondered what you'd say if somebody said, what's your position as an archaeologist?
Yeah.
You know, what is that? I mean, you say you're sort of more aligned to the
Polisario. Well, I mean, they're the guys we work with, and we think in the ethics of this, you've got a territory that has been occupied and colonized. So I think it would certainly be unethical to work with the occupier and colonizer. You're legitimizing the occupation. I mean, the fact that Western Sahara is recognized by the United Nations as a non-self-governing territory whose post-colonial status is still to be determined, the fact that the Polisario government is recognized by the African Union, then I think the majority of African nations, to me, that's fine. You know, we're not, I think ethically sort of we're sound. When it comes to using the archaeology for nationalist purposes, I want no part of it on either side. So, you know, I think I've been sort of pleasantly surprised. It's one of the things I was worried about when I mean, I'm not an archaeologist by background, so, you know, I went in with a certain level of naivety as well. but I was pleasantly surprised at how little interference there was. You know, they're keen to get it publicised. I think they realised that we wouldn't, you know, have any trouble with sort of it being, you know, co-opted for sort of, well, so it has been co-opted into the conflict in terms of the nationalist narrative, in terms of they now see it as their heritage and so on. I think that's, it's in their territory, fine, you know. But in terms of what the archaeology says about who has the rights to the land, no, I'm not getting involved in that. And as I said, I've been pleasantly surprised at how little of that has been. So, you know, I know that that's something you keep an eye out for, and that could easily become a stage where you suddenly feel very uncomfortable with where that's being used. I haven't got to that stage there. So they're quite hands-off. You know, they provide logistical support, and they've never sort of asked us to interpret anything in a particular way, or to publish anything, or to write or say anything specific. They just let us get on with it. So that's. But yeah, the dangers there.
In comparison to the Armenian, I mean, I think it's a lot of parallels.
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah, yeah, definitely. I know we had some questions. Did you have a question over there? Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Related to, is there differences in the functionality of the stone structures? Have you noted any trend in, like these are the burial mounds, but are you also seeing like the crescents are also burial mounds?
Yeah.
If they are, is it an expression of hierarchy or a change in culture? Are you seeing any such trend?
We, as I said, we've only excavated two monuments of a very similar type. So I can talk about sort of what's known from the wider Sahara. But I know, actually, in recent years, at least one team excavated to Gule. I have a colleague so much, but somebody else who's interested in the region who's done a lot of amateur work in the Sahara. He got a team together, and he's very interested in the Gule monuments. So you know, those there. He excavated one and found no evidence of any burial underneath it. So, you know, whether these are burials, it remains a sort of matter of conjecture. I suspect where you've got a tumulus, it probably are, but who knows? Obviously, we have a lot of standing stones. We haven't excavated any of those sites. How you'd excavate a fantastic assemblage of standing stones without doing some damage is it's a matter that we'd worry about. I don't think they'll be associated with burials. My hunch is that no, the standing stones are probably not burials, at least the assemblages of maybe dozens of standing stones. But they have the quartz. They tend to be in areas where you have a lot of burials, so there may be some other sort of ritual purpose there that's, you know, related to burial and death, but they're not burials themselves. There are other sort of stone structures that we see. So you see just sort of areas where there's like a circular stone pavement, or another thing we see is stone half circles and stone rings. Our hunch is that those probably aren't burials. They may not be at all funerary in nature. But again, until we excavate, we don't know. So I think you're absolutely right. There are some structures that we can say, yeah, these are almost certainly burials. The ones that have been excavated have all been burials. Crescents that have been excavated elsewhere have had burials in them. And, you know, one of the interpretations from people working in the Central Sahara is that what we're seeing with the emergence of monumental stone burial structures is, you know, you're seeing the beginnings of social hierarchy, you're seeing a move to sort of more complex societies. And the emergence of, I guess, basal patriarchy as well. I think the excavations we've done suggest that, you know, you tend to have male interments in the big ones and so on. And, you know, people speculate about, well, this is happening at a time of increasing climatic sort of uncertainty and aridity, when and they're associated with cattle herders, as far as we can tell. There have been burials that have had, you know, cattle remains in them. Cattle burials as well in Libya have been excavated. And so I think there's, you know, several things going on here, maybe. We're seeing evidence that people are sort of, or cattle herding is spreading westward. It's associated with mobility. It's associated, as far as we can, you know, assume, with increased mobility. That means people sort of going to new areas, new territories. It means people sort of leapfrogging from one location to another. So what do you do when you go into a new area? Well, landmarks are helpful. So maybe the burials are sort of serving navigational purposes, who knows? I think more likely they're serving to associate particular population groups with the landscape, saying, we are here, you know, our ancestors are here, we're tied to the land. So not a nationalist purpose, but something sort of akin to it in terms of, you know, putting a stamp of ownership on a place. And I think this is something that we see sort of across cultures across the world, as burials, particularly monumental burials, associate particular groups with particular locations and areas. So I think we've got that happening. And with the monumentality of some of the burials and the sort of different degrees of monumentality, then it's perfectly sort of reasonable to speculate that, yes, we are possibly seeing something that is to do with social hierarchy emerging, and certain, you know, members of a group becoming or being perceived as more important or more valuable. Doesn't necessarily have to be in terms of traditional sort of leadership roles, that the guy in the big tomb is the leader. Maybe there was someone who was particularly valued, a healer or something, or, you know, who knows. But yes, I think we've got a number of processes, got two or three different things going on here, that sort of you know, familiarization with the landscape, the landmarks. The landmarks also feed into the territoriality as well. It's one and the same, I think, to advertise to other groups that you're there. But also, you know, maybe if you are becoming more mobile, it becomes more important to have a fixed, visible place where you can, you know, pay your respects to your ancestors or something. I mean, it's all very, very speculative, but yeah, I think that's going on. And then I think you have the other things that are maybe more functional. I'm sure some of the monuments that we see, or some of the stone structures, for example, that we've seen in the southern sector, a number of sort of very sort of discrete, sort of not very spectacular sort of stone circles with particular alignments of stones, and, you know, maybe sort of more vertical stones on one side facing a particular direction. And I reckon a lot of these are probably navigational aids, or maybe to do with tracking the seasons. So, you know, where is it time for the monsoon rains yet? So, you know, when the sun is rising here and down this corridor of the Goulet, maybe that's what you can expect. So I think, yeah, lots of different functions going on there. But as I said, until we sort of get out there and dig a load of stuff up, I mean, unless we do that, we're not necessarily going to do that. A lot of it is quite speculative. But I think we can do more by looking at a lot of the alignments and looking at more of the sort of astronomical or potential astronomical purposes of some of these as well. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Gentlemen.
I don't know whether you answered my question in response to the first question, but whose heritage is this?
That's the question for me to answer. So, I mean, I guess the answer would be it's not for me to say. It's I think there's a sense there's an issue like stewardship there. So the people who control an area or a country have a responsibility, or not if you don't care, I guess. But you can say they have a responsibility for managing the heritage. So you could say that in the Moroccan occupied areas, that's Morocco's responsibility. Does it mean that it's their heritage? It's so, when you get into that question, I think this is what you're getting at as well, is that the question of whose heritage it is does become tied up with who lives here, who has the rights to the land, and so on. Yeah, exactly, yeah. So, and that's, I think, what you're saying with Turkey and Armenia is when you have two groups claiming the same heritage as part of their own national identity, and it certainly wouldn't be the first or the second time. Yes.
The state of Macedonia.
Yes, sure. Greece
says it's our heritage. Republic of Macedonia.
Yes. Yes. I think that, I guess that the to me the logical thing is to say, okay, if this particular heritage is physically located in your territory or country, it's yours effectively in terms of looking after it and preserving it, not just for yourself, but for, you know, anybody else or for future generations. The fact that, you know, the question of the status, the territorial status of Western Sahara is not resolved means that the question of whose heritage is not resolved either. So that's my cop out answer, I guess.
Well, that was the question. Who actually takes responsibility.
And I guess the answer, certainly for
UNESCO.
Yeah, and UNESCO probably not, well, I don't know if they're going to not do it in any disputed territory, but I think certainly Western, because of their strong presence in Morocco, and knowing how Morocco works when it comes to asserting its rights as it sees over Western Sahara, they'd be very, very proactive in preventing any UNESCO. In fact, when the vandalism episode occurred, Minurso did approach UNESCO. Minurso is the peacekeeping force. They approached UNESCO for assistance with restoring the site. You would have thought this is exactly UNESCO's bag, but UNESCO didn't want anything to do with it. All they did was give them the name of an expert, an independent expert who might be able to help them, who was somebody who'd already been suggested by our Spanish colleagues. So, you know, they really want to keep it at arm's length. So. But yeah, I guess ideally that's what you'd want. You want a body like UNESCO to say, while this territorial dispute is going on, we will take responsibility for managing the heritage. They're doing the opposite, so because of the conflict. So, yeah. So there's another question back there. Yeah.
Talking about speculations, do you think the fact we have standing stones could be related to Medinitism from England to Ethiopia?
Well, I guess in a sense it's the same sort of thing. I think I alluded to this little bit with the talk of the connections with the Atlantic Sahara. So, you know, it's very tempting to sort of make links between what you can call the Sahara megalithic if you want, but certainly the period of monument building in the Sahara, to make links between that and European megalithism, for example. And I've always said, no, they're separate things. But talking with my colleague Joe Clark, who I co-direct the project with, about sort of these sorts of things and looking at the work that she and colleagues have, or that, you know, colleagues and friends of hers have been doing on Atlantic Europe, she's saying the similarities are actually incredible between Western Sahara and some of the European stuff. So I think there's the possibility of a relation. I don't necessarily think that what we're seeing in the Sahara, in the Central Sahara, is, you know, physically related to what's going on in Europe. I think we're talking about separate traditions there that probably emerged independently. But I think when we get to the sort of Atlantic fringes and Western Sahara and these possible communications routes along the old river channels, I think there's a possibility that these two different traditions meet and begin to mix up. So I think the answer is that there's a possible connection there, yeah. And if you think about navigation, people were traveling up and down the sort of eastern Atlantic seaboard throughout Europe. Why not down to Africa? We know that there was communication with the coast as far as sort of certain parts of Morocco. So why not further? And if you're going to go further, there are only certain places that you can land because of the nature of the coast. There are only certain places that you can actually, you know, then get inland, and it's along those old river routes. So I think it's something that's quite an exciting possibility that we should pursue. I guess I don't really give you a very definite answer, I'm afraid. But yeah. Have any more questions or comments?
I think before thanking Nick, can I just announce that next week we have two York seminars. One is on Monday, and usually at 5 o'clock, and it's in association with History of Art. And we have distinguished anthropologist Tim Ingold coming, and he's talking on what appears to be a sort of art subject, but Tim Ingold makes connections into all sorts of spheres, and I think it should be interesting. And Wednesday we have Jose Iriarte, who is paleo archaeologist, and talking about his work in the Amazon.
Yes.
Before you pause again, do join us afterwards if you want. We're going for drinks and something to eat at Harkins in town. But can we thank Nick?
Pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, please do come and join us in Harkins.
Thank you very much.
Sorry. And